That you are worthy of all our praise, oh God. Hallelujah, Father, we don't need to be riled up. Lord, we worship you because you're God and you're King. Lord, we worship you because you're God. You are righteousness, Lord. You are holiness. You are love. We praise your name, Jesus. We praise your name, Jesus. There is none like you, Lord, in all the earth. In all the earth, Jesus, there is none like you. We worship you, Lord. We worship you.
Oh,
Jesus, 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 King Jesus, 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 King Jesus. Jesus, 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 King Jesus, King Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, God. We praise you, Jesus. We praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you. We praise you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, 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 Jesus. Praise you, God. Praise you, God. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. The splendor of the King. Rejoice, and all the earth rejoice.
Father, I don't think we understand how great you really are. But the more we keep singing and confessing and declaring such a thing, is the more that we'll understand your greatness. So Father, tonight, my heart, my mind, my mouth declare how great is our God. Thank you, God, for being great to me. Hallelujah. So Father, tonight, again, I'm glad I'm here. I'm glad everybody else is here, but I'm glad you're here. Because if you'd stayed home, we'd have no reason to be here. Thank you, Father. Thank you. So be blessed tonight. We lift up your name, Jesus, for you to be glorified. In your name, Lord, amen. Amen. Praise God. Well, guys, go ahead and be all kinds of friendly and nice and handshaky and everything else. Thank you. Well, glory to God. Yes, it's warm in here. It's the way it goes. This will be my first of my annual speech. It's that time of year when it's hard to govern the temperature in this room. It's the way it is, but praise God, we have a room. And it's paid for, and it's beautiful, and praise God for it, you know? Now, for those of you watching, we do know that from time to time there have been issues relative to the streaming. We don't really think it's all our fault. But, you know, if you contact the streaming company, they're going to tell you, well, it's your internet service provider. Then if you contact the internet service provider, they're going to say, oh, no, 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 no. It's your streaming company. Nobody wants to take the blame for anything. So anyway, we are aware of it. However, one of the things that you might not know to do, and that is if the image on your computer locks up, hit Control and F5 at the same time. Hit the Control key, hold it down, and then hit the F5 key. And what that does is refresh your computer for the streaming. It doesn't turn your computer off. It just refreshes your internet connection, if you will. And very often, that takes care of the problem. Now, I'm not saying that will take care of the problem every single time, but that does help quite a bit. In fact, there have been times when here in the church, my computer in my office here at the church has been logged on to watch the service just to monitor what's happening, and it has locked up. Well, hit Control F5, it refreshes and continues on. So I just wanted to pass that along to you. That's something that really a lot of people don't know you can do. Again, continue to pray for our conference. And once again, there is a young lady who is going to arrive at the airport Saturday night at 9:30, the Saturday before the conference, and she'll need a ride to the hotel. And if you are able to help out in that area, please let us know. Give you all of the information you need to pick her up. And she and we will be very grateful. Praise God. It's her first time to come here, by the way. Be her first conference. In 1 Samuel chapter 4, you don't have to turn to it. I'm going to give you a recap. I was going to, you know, read a whole lot of this, but sometimes people get a little sleepy when it's warm. So we're going to kind of move along here. I understand. So does God, but I'll do a good job of recapping. In 1 Samuel chapter 4, he had a priest named Eli. Sorry, Porky Pig. Eli. So anyway, he had a priest named Eli, and he had two sons, Hophni and Phinehas. Well, it was a dysfunctional family. And Hophni and Phinehas, man, they were priests, but these guys were charlatans. I mean, they were fooling around with women. They were absconding with offerings. It was a mess. Well, the Philistines attacked. And the armies of Israel went out to fight the Philistines, and things weren't going too well. So the army said, hey, I know. Let's bring the ark to the battlefield, and then we'll win. So they got a message to Hophni and Phinehas. We need the ark. And they said, okay. So they brought the ark. And as they were bringing the ark, and the Israelite armies saw the ark, yay, I mean, this roar went up. And the Philistines, they said, you know, what's this? What's going on? Somebody in their group knew what the deal was. They said, well, they just brought the ark of their god in. And, you know, it's the god that messed up all of Egypt. So, guys, look, it's not good for us. We're going to die, but hey, let's go into the battle and die like men. The Philistines said, yes, amen, that's right. So, the Philistines, this is my version, the Philistines charged into the battle, and the Israelites, I mean, they knew they were going to win because they had the ark. Well, guess what? The Philistines start whooping up on the Israelites, and the Israelites, they can't figure out what the deal is. And a bunch of the Israelites get killed. Hophni and Phinehas, they get killed. And to make matters worse, the Philistines captured the ark. Well, the Philistines took the ark, and at first they weren't too sure what to do with it. So they tried a few things, and they started having some problems. It's like everywhere the ark went, something bad happened. And they're wondering, like, what is going on with this thing? In fact, I mean, a bunch of them, they got hemorrhoids. And it's called emrods in the Bible, all right? So a bunch of them got emrods. And this was before Preparation H was invented, so things weren't good. By the time it was over, by the time the Philistines got rid of the ark, over 50,000 of them had died. Just go back and read the whole story. Pretty interesting, really. Well, they decided, man, we got to do something. So they put the ark on a cart. And you can read about this back over in 1 Samuel chapter 6, verse 1 through 1 Samuel chapter 7, verse 1. But they put the ark on a cart, and it was weird. They made these gold hemorrhoids and mice, and I mean, just weird-looking stuff. It's like, come on, seriously? You know, who does something like that? Well, they didn't know. I mean, they're just a bunch of ignorant Philistines. You know, what do you expect? So anyway, they put the ark on his cart, and they slapped the cows, and they said, get out of here. So the cows took off. And the ark ended up in the house of this guy named Abinadab. Well, it was there in Abinadab's house for a long time, because after this is when Saul became king and did all the stuff that he did. And then he died. Then David became the king. And all kinds of problems ensued. David trying to reunite the nation of Israel and Judah and all. Well, one day, David gets to thinking about all this. And he realizes, you know, that ark belongs with us. So we need to go get it. And in chapter in 2 Samuel, go ahead and turn over to 2 Samuel. Well, in 2 Samuel chapter 5, the Philistines heard that David had been anointed the king. And anyway, they end up in this near confrontation. I mean, anyway, just read about it in chapter 5. But we get to chapter 6. And it says that David, in verse 1, gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000, like the elite troops, whatever. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from Baal of Judah to bring up from thence the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts, that dwelleth between the cherubims. That's the cherubims on top of the ark, the lid, on the lid of the ark. If you ever saw the movie Raiders of the Lost Ark, remember that? I mean, that really was a pretty good rendering of the ark. That's one thing about that movie that I enjoyed, was how they seemed to be very faithful with the design of the ark. And it says here in verse 3 that they set the ark of God upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeah, and Uzzah and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove the new cart. And they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeah, accompanying the ark of God, and Ahio went before the ark. And David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments made of fir wood, even on harps and on psalteries and on timbrels and on cornets and on cymbals. In other words, man, they are praising. They are worshiping. They're having a Holy Ghost party, if you will. They are so excited about the fact that the ark is coming back to where it belongs. Well, when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark and took hold of it, and the oxen shook it. In other words, the oxen stumbled, and the cart looked like it might fall off the cart. And the angel of the Lord was, or the anger, the angel. The angel, okay, wait a minute. That word is A-N-G-E-R. I can see it in my Bible. That's the word anger. Yeah, so much for that spelling bee, right? And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and there he died by the ark of God. And David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah, and he called the name of the place Perez Uzzah unto this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day, and said, "How shall the ark of the Lord come unto me?" So David would not remove the ark of the Lord unto him into the city of David, but David carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom the Gittite 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. And it was told King David, saying, "The Lord hath blessed the household of Obed-Edom and all that pertaineth unto him, because of the ark of God." So David went and brought up the ark of God from the house of Obed-Edom into the city of David with gladness. And it was so that when they that bear the ark of the Lord had gone 6 paces, he sacrificed oxen and fatlings. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, and David was girded with a linen ephod. So David and all the house of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouting and with the sound of the trumpet. Now, this is a pretty interesting story, because David is the king of Israel. And in this, David decides, you know what? We need to get the ark back home. Well, was that a good thing to do? Well, yeah, sure it was. Did it belong with the Jews? Yes, it did. So did David have were his intentions wrong? Well, no, his intentions weren't wrong. And you look here and it says in verse 3, they set the ark of God upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab. They put it on a new cart. Well, I don't know about you, but, you know, on the surface, that doesn't seem like such a bad idea. I mean, you want to get the thing from where it is to where it ought to be. So, use a cart. Just put it on the cart. But there's a problem with that. And if you look back over in Exodus 25, keep your finger here in 2 Samuel 6. Look in Exodus 25, verse 10. God's talking to Moses about the ark, how it's to be built, and how it's to be moved. He says, "And they shall make an ark of shittim wood, 2 cubits and a half shall be the length thereof, and 1.5 cubits the breadth thereof, and 1.5 cubits the height thereof. And thou shalt overlay it with pure gold within, and without shalt thou overlay it. And thou shalt make upon it a crown of gold round about. And thou shalt cast 4 rings of gold for it, and put them in the 4 corners thereof. And 2 rings shall be in the one side of it, and 2 rings in the other side of it. And thou shalt make staves of shittim wood," in other words, like poles, "and overlay them with gold. And thou shalt put the staves into the rings by the sides of the ark, that the ark may be borne with them. The staves shall be in the rings of the ark. They shall not be taken from it." And then he goes on and talks about things that will be in the ark. So, here's what we have. They're supposed to have these staves or these poles that go through the rings. And then the priests are supposed to bear the ark, you know, the poles like on their shoulder, and then carry it that way. Now that was in the law. But David said let's get a new cart. And let's put it on a new cart. This seemed okay to David. And I'm sure to a lot of other people it made a lot of sense. I mean, after all, you know, you want to move it. The problem I have with this is, where did David get that idea? Where did he come up with this idea that you could move the cart that way? He's a Jew. He has access to the law. He has access to priests. But he decided on a new cart. Well, you don't have to turn back to it, but in 1 Samuel chapter 6, we see that what the Philistines did was make a new cart and put the ark on it and send it on its way. And it's very possible that's where David got the idea. I don't know. But I do know this. Just because he was the king, God did not make an exception. And David, I really am mystified by this. That why David, because he had such a heart for God, why didn't he know this already? Or why didn't he consult with the priests and ask them, what should we do so that more people don't die? But David just assumed it would be okay to put it on the cart. Well, they put it on the cart. And everything is going fine until we get to verse 6. And it says, when they came to Nacon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark and took hold of it, for the oxen shook it. Now, this seemed okay to Uzzah. I mean, you know, the thing's about to fall. I mean, this is the ark of God here, all right? Got King David and everybody else is watching, so you better keep it from falling. So he reaches out and he grabs it. He thought it was okay. Were his intentions good? Yes. He's trying to preserve the ark. And the last thing you want to do is have your name in the Bible as the guy who got the ark messed up, okay? So he's kind of thinking ahead, all right? You know, when they write the Bible, I want to be a cool guy. So he had good intentions. He meant well. He's trying to help. So he reaches out to steady the ark. Well, the problem is that it wasn't okay with God. And it says that the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and there he died by the ark of God. Well, that sounds almost kind of mean, doesn't it? I mean, really? I mean, come on, God. You're a God of mercy. I mean, what's the deal? Cut this guy some slack. He's trying to help you out here. The problem is, boy, how do you say this? God cuts people slack. But Uzzah should have known better. And you weren't supposed to do that with the ark. Well, what about all them Philistines that touched it? Well, a bunch of them died, but I can't find that any of them died because they touched it. A bunch of them died because they looked in it. But as far as just touching it, I don't see that God struck somebody dead. See, the ark wasn't given to the Philistines. It was given to the Jews. And the law was given to the Jews, not the Philistines. So, you know, bottom line is, rules are rules. Don't touch the ark. Well, he did, and he died. Now, verse 8. David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah. Now, this word breach is an interesting word. This word breach, it comes from a Hebrew word, peretz. And part of its meaning is bursting forth. The image that presents is that when he touched it, he blew up. That's gross. You say, you mean God made the guy blow up? Well, a bursting forth. I mean, what's it sound like to you? Now, I agree. Maybe he just fell over and died. But that's not what that word means. It implies, really, a violent death. And then it says that David was displeased. Now that word, displeased, that's a very nice sounding word. However, in the Hebrew, it's the word kara. It means glow with anger, be incensed, grow indignant, burn, the heat of anger. David was mad. He was mad. Who was he mad at? Well, he wasn't mad at Uzzah. Well, it says right here, take a look. It says he was displeased because the Lord had blew Uzzah up. I know that's the modern gym version or something. He's mad at God. He's mad at God. Now, why is he mad at God? Because God didn't honor David's way of doing things. How dare you not honor what I'm doing for you? Do you not realize I'm trying to bring the ark back to your people? Do you remember you anointed me to be the king? God, remember that thing with Goliath? All the stuff that I've done for you? And this is how you thank me? See, this is a message for all Christians. Just because you have good intentions, it doesn't mean that God will honor those intentions. He's not going to violate his word. He's not. Now, you keep reading in this. We'll get back to that here in just a moment. And it says here in verse 9, David was afraid of the Lord that day, and said, how shall the ark of the Lord come to me? It's like, wait a second. You don't know? You have the scriptures. You have the law. And if you were raised properly, you knew the first five books, the Pentateuch. In the Pentateuch was contained the instructions on how to move the ark. Okay, I'll grant you, that's a lot of stuff to remember, those five books. But you're telling me that you couldn't find a priest anywhere who couldn't look it up? You know, how is it you didn't know? In fact, if you look here in verse 10, it says David wouldn't remove the ark of the Lord into the city of David. He, you know, put it in the house of Obed-Edom, and the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. 3 months. It took him 3 months to figure out how to do this. It took him 3 months to find a priest, and he could ask the priest, okay, look, here's what's happened. You know, this guy over here, and touch, and blow up, and, you know, how are we supposed to move the ark? The priest would have said, David, come on, man. You know, you were in my Bible class. Don't you remember when we covered this? The ark had to be moved with the staves in the rings. David, you knew this, or you should have known it. Oh, okay. Well, then, word gets back to David, hey, look, man, Obed-Edom is being blessed. But then it says in verse 13 that when they that bear the ark of the Lord. Now, this is very similar wording to what we read back. Okay, I'm just going to, you know, the first five books of the Pentateuch, all right, when it's talking about moving the ark and all that wording right there, they that bear the ark, okay, that's very similar to how it's referred to, you know, way back when they first started carrying the ark around. So he gets it right in verse 13. But it took him 3 months to consult with the law? 3 months? Somebody's died. You know, you should have been acting on this very quickly. See, for Christians, we can have, like I mentioned earlier, the best intentions of the world, the kind of intentions that God would say, hey, I appreciate this. You know, yes, this is something that you should do. But if, like David, our methods are wrong, God is not going to honor what we do if it means violating His word. It's not going to happen. This is a major stumbling block for a lot of Christians, because there are a lot of believers who are doing things the way they think they should do them. They're doing things the way that maybe they've been told to do them, or maybe the way they've seen other people do them. And then they're expecting God to move in a mighty way on their behalf. For example, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. There it is. What are you going to do? And you have a lot of Christians who want to brag about how faith comes all these other ways. No, it does not. Well, I got sick, got hurt, went through this problem, had this, lost my job, blah, blah, blah. And boy, did my faith ever show up, build, grow, develop, come. No, it didn't. No, it didn't. I mean, you can say what you want, but it did not. Because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. In the kingdom, there are certain ways things are done. That's it. They are the laws of the kingdom, if you will. Just like the law that was given to the Jews. God said, wood poles covered in gold, through the rings, pick it up, carry it. That's how you move the ark. Well, we see what happened when you do it your own way. People die. And David got upset. He had no reason to get upset. He had no right to get upset. He had human nature that could get upset. But as far as the law was concerned, he had no right to get upset. Because the law said, no, that's not how you do it. And God did not make an exception. Well, see today, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. He's not going to make an exception. This is how it is. So if there's no word coming in to me, faith isn't coming. And if there's no word going into you, faith isn't coming. That's the way it is. Well, Brother Martin, that means I have to do something different than what I've been doing. Bingo! Because what, you know, that saying, you know, well, I've been doing such and such. You know, yeah, well, how's that been working for you? Well, I can answer that regarding, you know, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. If you're trying it some other way, I can tell you that's not been working for you. I don't have to ask. I can tell you that's not been working for you because faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God. That's it. That is the process in the kingdom. Exclusive. That's it. No other way. Well, along with that, you build yourself up on your most holy faith praying in the Holy Ghost. Well, I don't really need that Holy Ghost stuff. You know, I can build myself up on my most holy faith by praying with the understanding. No, you can't. Yes, I can. No, you can't. I certainly can. I know I can. Well, how do you know that? Because I know I can. Okay. All right. What is the foundation for that belief? Well, somebody said. A preacher. Okay, well, what was the foundation for his belief? Because see, I'm telling you that the foundation for my belief is recorded in the book of Jude, and it says, but ye, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Okay, so I build myself up on my most holy faith by praying in tongues. That is the kingdom standard, and you can't get around it. Now, granted, it's the correct thing to do to pray with the understanding. However, to build ourselves up on our most holy faith, it requires praying in tongues. Okay, now you know what this means? That means that if you're not praying in tongues, you're not building yourself up on your most holy faith. This is not rocket science, but it is a severe challenge to the belief system of a lot of Christians. If you never pray in tongues, then you're not building yourself up on your most holy faith. If you belong to a church that teaches against it and tells people don't do it, that it's not for today or however they present it, do you realize that church is telling people, instructing people how to not build themselves up on their most holy faith? The Bible says pray in tongues and it happens. They say don't do it. So then you have a whole bunch of people that think everything is working out for them the way that it should, that they're being built up on their faith and so forth, and they never pray in tongues. Okay, what makes you think that you can be built up on your most holy faith any other way? Trials and tribulations? No. No. I am God, I change not. Now that's in Scripture. And that was true for the Old Testament and the New. He changes not. And it's like if God were here tonight, he could say, look, if you doubt that, talk to Uzzah. Now see, a lot of Christians, you know, they want to live their life in Christ the way Frank Sinatra sang. I did it my way. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. Well, boy, I tell you what, you know, my Gitche Gumi's been hurting. Hoo-wee. Boy, that Gitche Gumi's been acting up. I mean, the doctor said that it's all inflamed and it's infected and it's just all messed up and it could spread throughout my body and all that. And, well, what are you going to do about it? Oh, hey, listen, it's a done deal. What's a done deal? My healing. It is. Well, how did that happen? Oh, listen. I was watching TV, and the preacher, he looked right in that camera, and he said, if you need a healing in your body, you need to sow the biggest offering you can, because there is a healing anointing at work this very moment. So I sat down, and I wrote that guy a check for $500. I got my healing. Really? I see in Scripture that there is a kingdom principle that says, by Jesus' stripes, you were healed. I also see a kingdom principle talks about lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. And that's really, I mean, I can see more kingdom principles related to this, but those two ought to be enough to get you going. But what I don't see is sow a financial offering seed for healing. I don't see it in there. It ain't there. What you're trying to do is put the ark on a cart. And it doesn't work. It looks like it's working in that somebody said it would work. But as soon as you hit the threshing floor, it's not going to work. You understand the symbolism here? You cannot sow an offering for a healing. You know, this sermon tonight has probably eliminated me from being invited to preach in thousands of churches all over. All right, cross him off the list. He's a fanatic. Hallelujah. Now, see, it doesn't work any other way. It doesn't. And when we get to looking in Scripture to find out these standards, the sower soweth the word. Well, okay, the word produces. I mean, we can go on and on with this, but what I'm getting at is when you go through the kingdom standards recorded here in the Bible, God's telling you how it works. He's telling you how to transport the ark. He's telling you what brings His promises. And if you try to put the ark on the cart, it may look good, it may sound good, and just like with David and all the people, he had 30,000 people with him that day. 30,000 of the choice of Israel. 30,000. That's a lot of people. And if Uzzah really did explode, I'm not trying to get too gross here, just a little bit. If he really did explode the way that word implies, do you realize there would have been bits and pieces of Uzzah on people? That's kind of gross. Honey, what is that? A bunch of Uzzah. Word would have spread very quickly. I ain't getting near that cart. I ain't getting near that ark. I ain't getting near nobody. I'm going home. Well, see, when we try to do things our way, and part of the problem is we have people telling us, well, hey, I did it and it worked for me, just like the Philistines would have said, hey, we put the thing on an ark, or put the ark on a cart and we moved it. I mean, until we looked in the thing, we didn't have a whole lot of problems other than the hemorrhoid thing. I mean, other than that, you know, stuff was going, you know, fairly well. And so we could say, well, hey, you know, the Philistines, they put it on a cart and they touched it and they didn't die. So if it worked for them and their church, then hey, why can't it work for us too? And so churches are putting the ark on the cart all the time. And they're teaching people to put the ark on a cart instead of going to the, quote, law, the law of the kingdom, to find out what has God really said? What has God established that really works? See, listen, there's a lot that I could teach, but I still need to read the Bible too. Now, I'm preaching to me. You can just listen in. I need it. I'm not exempt. Remember David? He was the king, but he still did something wrong, and God did not exempt him. Hey, I've got, listen, if David had been the one to touch that ark, he'd have been the one that blew up, even though God had chosen him to be the king. The word is the word, and God's not going to violate it. Now, I agree, there are a lot of things in the Old Testament that it just seems really confusing, as though God does compromise. Well, he doesn't. And there are a lot of things in Scripture that I don't fully understand yet. And in a way, I praise God for that, because that means I have the excitement of learning more. But for us as believers, we have to find out what works in the kingdom. I'm born again, and I've been translated out of the power of darkness into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Now, what works in the kingdom? And really, one of the best things you could do is severely limit or completely eliminate Christian television. Yeah, I know, take him out and stone him for saying that. But, hey, listen, your experience may be different from mine, but I have yet to find any Christian channel that is consistent with doctrine. If you've got the money, you can be on the channel. And I've seen this. One preacher will be on there, and I know that preacher does not believe in the gifts of the Spirit, does not believe in divine healing and so forth. And then the next preacher, the next hour comes on, and this is some kind of Spirit-filled, full gospel, speak in tongues, get your miracle now preacher. It's like, wait a second. For the casual observer, which is it? What am I supposed to believe? That's why, you know, get rid of this stuff. thing is, all those people mean well, they're trying to help. But Uzzah was trying to help. And David was trying to do what he thought would work to get the ark back into to Jerusalem, to the people of God, to the Jews, because that's where it belonged. Well, see, guys, we can try all we want. We can do everything that we think works, but if it is not confirmed as a principle in the kingdom, it's not going to work. Oh, I may feel really good doing it, because until the Uzzah thing, everybody with David was feeling pretty good about this thing. You know, hey, here comes the ark. Hallelujah. They're playing the instruments. They're praising God. Man, I mean, it must have been like a party for them. They were so happy. Can't wait till we get back to Jerusalem. And I'm going to be able to say that I was a part of the group that brought the ark back. Man, we're going to have stories to tell our grandchildren. We saw the ark. We helped get it back into Jerusalem. We helped get it back to our people. Well, then all of a sudden, kabloomy. It's like, what kind of stories you got to tell now? Here's what you tell your grandkids now. You do it God's way. You do it God's way. And avoid an explosive situation. I hope the guy just dropped over dead. I hope he didn't blow up, really. You do it God's way. That's it. You do it God's way. And for a lot of Christians, to do it God's way means you have to rethink what you do, period. You have to rethink what you believe, period. And I could stand here, I'm not, and just go through a lot of things that I've heard taught over the years that I thought were right, that even I did, because they told me it was okay. They said this is what you do. And listen, just because somebody can go back to the Old Testament and find an example that something happened, okay, I'll use this one. I'll use this one. And I don't mean to stomp on anybody's toes or embarrass anyone, but it is what it is. I mean, hey, I read the story of Israel when they crossed the Jordan. There was Jericho, insurmountable, enemy city. What God tell them to do? March around Jericho. March around once a day, and on the last day, you know, seven times, go around. Then, whoo, the walls fell. Victory, victory, the enemy is defeated. And so now, you have preachers standing up telling everybody to do Jericho marches. Yeah. We're going to beat the devil. How are you going to do that? You're going to walk in circles around the building. A Jericho march. In fact, seriously, there might be somebody somewhere in a church teaching that right now. In fact, there might be a congregation right now getting ready to walk outside their church building and do a Jericho march around their property. And they're doing it because they believe this is how you engage in spiritual warfare. Here's the problem. I don't see it. I'm having a hard time envisioning Jesus saying to the apostles, "All right, boys, line up. It's time for the Jericho march. Yep. We're going to beat the devil." What? When they got across the Gadarenes, they got out of that boat, and that demon-possessed fella comes running up, acting all demon-possessed. Jesus didn't say, "All right, guys, let's line up. Let's do a Jericho march around this guy. Cast the devil out of him." Now, some people hearing this message who believe in a Jericho march might get a little offended. I'm kind of being sarcastic and so. But it's not there. I mean, it's good for your exercise, okay? Granted. You lose a little weight, maybe. Burn some calories. But as far as defeating Satan, the only time God ever told anybody to do a Jericho march was at Jericho. That's it. Why do a Jericho march now when you have the name of Jesus? When we have been given the authority of Jesus in this earth, when we've been made more than conquerors, when He has given us the victory, when that is what we possess, and we're given the right to use the name of Jesus, why in the world would I want to spend my time walking in circles around whatever? But it sounds good, and you can build a great sermon on it and get everybody inspired. I've seen that happen in a sanctuary. Everybody, you know, Jericho March sermon, and everybody starts marching around, you know, the sanctuary. I was in a service one time in a tent where they preached on it, and they wanted all, I think it was all the men. That's right, it was all the men marching around the tent. And they were supposed to march like seven times around. And so, I mean, all right, you look like a doofus if you don't join in. So it's like, all right, I don't want to be the only one here. You know, oh, here we go, up two. And the thing is, I counted. I don't know if anybody else counted or not, but I counted the number of trips. They didn't do seven. And then they start cheering, yeah, and I'm thinking, wait a second, we didn't do seven. But again, you know, who's going to listen to me? So you know what? We didn't win the victory that night. Crazy thing is, we already had it. Okay, now, exception. I'll extend a little grace here. And if, for whatever reason, God would tell somebody, do a Jericho march, okay. But here's the problem. Everybody who does it says, well, God told me to go out there and walk around and do a Jericho march. Who's going to say, God told me not to do it, but you know, bless God, it worked for them Jews, and I think it's going to work for me too. Now, there are other things we could talk about. We're not. Here's what I'm getting at. Just because you're a child of the King, just because you're born again, washed in the blood of Jesus, just because you've been adopted, just because you're a joint heir with Jesus Christ, just because you are a king and a priest unto God by Jesus Christ, just because you may be an apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, or teacher, just because you're any or all of that, you still do not have the liberty to create your own kingdom law. You have to do it God's way. And the only way to know God's way is to get into the book and find out. I was misled in a lot of things by a lot of well-meaning preachers who were truly trying to help me grow in my walk with God. And you know, from that perspective, I do appreciate it. Even though they told me things that were wrong, they were trying to help me. So I appreciate the effort. And I look back on it and I appreciate my own hunger because I wanted to know what to do. Well, still, if it's not right, it's not right. So over the years, I've learned, I've grown, and now I understand I did a lot of things that really were a waste of time. Now, my goal was right. What I wanted to achieve was correct. And God would have commended me for that. In fact, you know, up there in heaven, He might have looked down and said, you know, Jim, I know what you're trying to accomplish. I appreciate that. Your heart is right. Your intentions are right. But son, you're going about it wrong. And this is just not going to work. I can't bless you the way that you think you're going to be blessed because you're not doing it the way I've said to do it. Well, see, as the years have passed, I've learned. And I'm still learning. We have to do it God's
way. Don't let preachers influence you toward doing something until you check it out in Scripture. Do it God's way, and you get God's promised results. It will work. Please stand. You know, a lot of people have to relearn a whole lot of things when it comes to this. But once you relearn, praise the Lord, you know, you just cast off the shackle of another tradition. And you're walking even in more freedom than what you had before. Father, I thank you that you don't compromise. Because if you compromised, then Father, what good would your word be? We could all create our own doctrines and our own principles. I thank you that you don't compromise. And I thank you that you've given us the Holy Spirit to help teach us the real way to do things. And Father, whatever there would be in my life that I'm doing or trying or whatever that is not a kingdom way, you know, show me. Help me see it. And I pray the same for all of those who are here, all of those watching, and all of those listening. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you for all the preachers who have helped me along the way, even though sometimes they said things that weren't right, they still had my best interest in heart. And Father, tonight, I thank you that your word has gone forth. It won't return void. May it accomplish the fullness of your will in our lives. Not just ours here, but Father, every person that's heard this, every person that's watched it, or will watch it. Thank you, Father. And again, I thank you that by Jesus' stripes we were healed. Say, Brother Martin, you know, you said that a lot here over the last several weeks and so forth, last few months. That's right. You know what? I find it interesting that as I have increased that declaration, more people in this church have been fighting physical battles. Why is that? Because Satan comes immediately to steal the word that was sown. You know what that tells me? That tells me we're making some progress and headway in this thing of healing, or somebody wouldn't be fighting so much. So, by Jesus' stripes, you were healed. All of you. Praise God. Hallelujah. All right, listen. We're going to go ahead and dismiss. Thank you guys for your patience. Thank you for staying awake. You did such a good job. If you have an offering tonight, please bring it up before you leave. And anything you'd like me to pray with you about before you go, I'll do that too. Other than that, you guys have a blessed remainder of this evening, and we'll see you again.